So good morning, everybody. Once again, I'll start over. Our last meeting, I forgot to turn on the recording, and so we didn't get that meeting recorded. So I asked everybody to remind me. So thanks very much for taking time out of your holiday weekend. I didn't realize it was a holiday weekend until I think Thursday. And so we really only have a few people today, but I'm happy that those of you who are here decided to come spend some time with us. In case there's anybody here today who doesn't know me, my name is Ann Thomas, and I'm the president of the Diablo Valley chapter. Zohair Chiba, Zohair, can you just say hello so people know you as our vice president? And Alan Katsura is our secretary.
Hello, everyone.
This has turned out to become an annual meeting that we have every September about emergency planning. You know, we live in a really precarious situation with global warming and all the fires that we have been experiencing in California. And the fires have been devastating. So this morning before everybody was arriving, I was mentioning to Zohair and Alan that actually giving this presentation is as much for me as for all of you every year, because I don't have all of my ducks in a row either. You know, every time I go ahead and review the presentation, I find, oh, I don't think I have that. Maybe I really need to do it this year. So before we get going, we'd like to give you some Zoom directions. By this time, almost everybody's really familiar with Zoom. But in case there's somebody who's joining us today who's still a little shaky about it, we want everybody to really become comfortable because Zoom isn't going away. So we show you how to use Zoom using your desktop. And we have a major slide that shows all of the parts. So if you look all the way to the left, you see the orange big button, and it's pointing toward a microphone. And that's how you turn the sound on and off for the microphone on the computer that you're using. Next to that is how you turn on the video camera, turning it on and off. And the reminder for the video camera is it's very easy to forget when your video's on, and everybody wants the video on because it helps with lip reading. To not do something you wouldn't want everybody on the meeting to see. Early on during the pandemic, a woman completely took off her top because she didn't remember that she was on video for everybody. So it's always a reminder. Don't pick your nose or take your clothes off, right? We encourage people to chat, and the green button points to the chat icon. And in the chat, when you do that, we ask that you please make sure that your name is there. And if you're not from our chapter, or even if you want to, if you're from our chapter, put the location where you're from so that we have an idea of being able to determine how many people across the country are joining us, because all of our meetings are posted on the HLA calendar and they're open to anybody in the United States. So the most important thing for all of us, of course, are the captions. And you see the CC, it says live transcript, and it's the blue button. And right now, everybody's captions, I believe, should be automatically running. But if something happened and they weren't, what you would do would click on that CC icon, and then you would click on show subtitles. As you can imagine, on these video calls, it's very difficult to figure out how to call on people for questions and answers and other things. So we ask that everybody please raise their hand. And what that does is in the participants list, it puts your hand, your raised hand, in the order that you raised it. So we don't have a problem that maybe somebody was waiting much longer than necessary. So if by some chance the captions weren't showing, you would click on the live transcript, and then three options are available. One is subtitles, subtitle settings, and full transcript. So if they weren't showing, you would turn on subtitles. If you think that the subtitles are too small and you would like to make them bigger, click on subtitle settings. And what happens is a window opens up and it has a sliding bar. And so you can slide that to be any size within reason that you want. Now, this third option is something that I think is really important. If you're like me and you're reading the captions, there are only two lines. And sometimes I realize after the third line has passed that there was something I didn't understand. So in the captions that are automatically streaming, I'm SOL. There's nothing I can do about that. But if I have the full transcript open on the right-hand side, there's a full transcript running, and I can just scroll back and find out what that word was that I may have missed. So I think that that's a really advantageous feature for us. So you may be wondering, how do I raise my hand when I want to ask a question? So if you look at that black toolbar at the bottom of your screen, you'll see a happy face with a plus, and it says reactions. Well, when you click on that reaction, the first option above the window, it says raise your hand. So if you want to raise your hand to ask a question or something else, you click on that and a hand shows up in your thumbnail, which is the picture of yourself, and also on our participants list. When you're finished talking, click on lower hand. In that section, there are also other emoticons that you can show approval or sadness. They're clapping hands, there's thumbs down. Feel free to use those. Another feature that I especially like is the ability to be able to make the presentation or the person larger or smaller, depending on which is the best for me. So for some people, they may want the presentation as big as it could possibly be, and they don't care as much about seeing the person's face who's talking because they have difficulty seeing. So see here that where this red circle is, and in the middle there are lines. If you click on that line, you can drag that back and forth, and it makes the presentation or the presenter larger or smaller. We'd like to remind everybody to speak a little bit slower. It aids in understanding for all of us, and it also helps the captioner to create accurate text for us. And this is as much for me as it is for any of you. When I get excited or I get nervous, I speak faster. So if I start talking too fast, somebody just please let me know. And if you didn't know this already, if you use an external microphone, it increases the clarity of the audio exponentially for everybody on the call. So right now I'm using this external microphone, and just by turning the microphone away, you can hear the difference in the sound. And microphones are not particularly expensive. So now we're going to get to the main part of our meeting today, and that's emergency planning. And I hope everybody is staying cool this weekend in whatever way you possibly can. I'm always so surprised as the sun changes that my house is actually cooler in September when it's 100 than it is in July when it's 100. Always just really surprises me. So at any rate, though, I'm prepared. You can see today I have on my sleeveless cool weather clothes. And when we have this hot weather like this, I have memory of the Oakland fire. We have other people who I know who are on this in our meeting today who've had family members who have been devastated by other fires in our state. And so it's something that needs to be close to all of our attention. Not only do we have wildfires, we have earthquakes. And we haven't had a sizable earthquake in quite a while. And many of the same things that we need for wildfires and other fires that we might have, we also need for earthquakes. So we need to be prepared for both. And of course, I suppose we could have flooding or even other things. The month of September is a national public service campaign to be ready. be ready for anything that could happen. So the first thing you need to do is to be informed of potential emergencies. You need to make a family plan. You need to build an emergency supply kit, and you need to be prepared for emergencies. And if you go to ready.gov, there are all kinds of tools on that website to help you take care of things. We don't list all of them in our presentation. We're just giving you the resources that are available to be able to help you. Our state also has assistance for us. Cal Fire has a program called Ready for Wildfire. And you can find information on that on readyforwildfire.org. And the things that are really important, you need to know how to get alerted. You need to plan and you need to know what to do. So the first thing that I would advise you to do is to get the Ready for Wildfire app and sign up for the text alerts. Now, something that I'm going to mention here on the text alerts, I don't know if everybody is aware of the fact that most smartphones have the ability to alert you by flashing your phone rather than just making a sound or a vibration. And I've had mine set like that for a really long time, and I find it very, very, very helpful. Even when I'm out and about, even since I've gotten my two very successful cochlear implants, I have not turned that feature off on my phone. I really like it. So what's the wildfire action plan? So obviously you need to create an evacuation plan. So some people's streets are only one way. Some people have areas where if they leave on one end of their street, it might be more difficult. If they left on the other, where's busy traffic? All those kinds of things. You need to have an emergency supply kit. You need to be prepared, ready, set, and go without having to think about everything. And you know that everything is taken care of. As people with hearing loss, we have needs that other people do not have, and those needs can have a profound impact on who we are and how we might engage in life immediately following a disaster, and even for a longer term if we're not able to return to our home. So your evacuation plan. You need to develop several different escape routes. What happens if one of them's blocked? What happens if the fire is coming down your street? So how else could you get out of the area where you are? You need to designate a meeting location outside of the fire hazard zone. So we were talking about this. We usually come on our call at least 15 minutes early to make sure everything's all set up and things. And we were kind of chatting about this since it's the topic today. So theoretically, someone in your family could be at home. Somebody could be at the grocery store. Somebody could be on a trip someplace else. There are all kinds of reasons why you would need to have a meeting location. So if something happened, you need to have a place where everybody would know that all of your family members are going to, so that you could all be accounted for. And to designate an out-of-area contact person. So it's possible that you wouldn't be able to call anybody locally. It's even possible you might not even be able to call somebody in the state. So if you had family members outside of the state or friends outside of the state, you could designate them as a contact person. Everybody in your family would contact them and say, could be your Aunt Mary, you know? And say, Aunt Mary, listen, this has happened, and I just want you to know that, and you'd set this up ahead of time, right? I'm okay, and this is where I am. So as everybody else calls in, you can let everybody know. So in your own home, there are things that you need to do in being prepared for fire and emergency. First of all, you need to have a fire extinguisher on hand. You need to know how to use it. And one of the most important things about learning how to use a fire extinguisher is where to direct the extinguisher in the fire. So you need to turn off your gas and electric water main. So most of us who I'm seeing who on our call today, or many of us, let's say many of us live in houses, it's easier for us to control that. And the gas shutoff valve has, it's like an X on the top. And I keep a key, it's like a big wrench, wired right outside my house so that in case I ever needed to turn that off, I wouldn't have to go look for it. It's right there. And I have the same thing at my water main. You need to have a list of emergency contact numbers near or in your emergency supply kit in case you need to use them. So the three steps to prepare, what do you need to do? You need to get a kit. You need to make a plan and you need to be informed. Now this get a kit can be anything that you want, a backpack, it can be a large plastic storage box, whatever works for you, just something that's easily identifiable. And Alan Katsura created this wonderful video for us. Something that we were discussing before everybody showed up was the whole idea about batteries, especially since so many devices today are rechargeable. So I happen to have an option with my advanced bionics cochlear implants that I can use rechargeable batteries, or they have an accessory that's a zinc air battery charger. And what it does is it replaces the battery pack and it has a pull-out piece that you can put zinc air batteries in and then take the rechargeable battery off. And I actually keep this in my purse because, you know, I never know where I would be, and without sound amplification I would be really in deep trouble. So Zohair was saying that he has rechargeable batteries and he never thought to ask if there was an accessory for that. So if you use rechargeable devices, instruments, and you haven't asked about whether there's a zinc air pack, it might be something that you definitely want to add to your list to ask the next time you talk to your hearing healthcare provider. So what things does a person with hearing loss need to have in their emergency supply kit? The very first thing that you need to have is the make, model, and serial number of your hearing devices. So I know Advanced Bionics sent me a card. I have a card that says exactly that I have two processors. I'll show you what it is. Oh, that's not it. Oh, see, it helps if you can find it, right? Maybe it's on the other side. And I have it in my wallet. Well, I did have it in my wallet. I don't know what I did with it now. See, so there you go. Maybe I lost mine, and that shows you how unprepared I am. I said I always find something. Anyway, so why this is especially important is that in the fires that happened in and around Santa Rosa a couple of years ago, everybody's fleeing willy-nilly, including all of the audiologists. The audiologist and hearing healthcare providers' offices burned down. And so they didn't know what make and model of hearing aid you had because they lost all their records. The San Francisco Speech and Hearing Center contacted the hearing aid manufacturers, and the hearing aid manufacturers said they would replace everybody's hearing instrument if they had the make, model, and serial number of those devices, because the manufacturer could track the device based on the serial number for the device, and all that information was lost with the audiologist. They couldn't have helped you, period. So you can imagine, you know, thinking about losing a $6,000 upward device and being without hearing amplification would be devastating. So that's a really small thing to do. And now I'm nervous. I wonder what I did with my card, right? So now I have to go look for it as soon as this meeting is done. Okay, so extra hearing aid batteries. So in Santa Rosa, CVS, Rite Aid, everything was burned out. You were completely closed out of that. So, you know, you're thinking, it's no problem. I'll just go buy some. Well, all of the places where you would buy them were also not open. So you couldn't have done that. So you need, as in the cute video from Alan, a battery charger for a smart device. And these battery chargers come in a wide variety of sizes. And when I say size, you could be this way or this way, but I actually mean by size, the power of the device. And it's important that you make sure that you get a device that's powerful enough for what you need. So I have a little one that I carry in my purse all the time for my phone. And it's this little tiny thing. It's about the size of two tubes of lipstick and a little bit fatter. And this will completely charge up my phone, but it's not enough to charge. It doesn't have enough power to charge my phone, to charge a laptop, or probably to even do my cochlear implants. So you buy them by, Alan, you're going to have to help me here. Is it AHS is what how they gauge the size of these things? Is that what that's called?
That's not that. It's, let's see.
Oh, the writing on here, you need a magnifying glass for it. Let's see.
It's M-A, yeah, it's M-A-H.
Oh, Alan's looking at his too. They're tiny. Oh, okay. Lowercase M, uppercase A, and lowercase H. So, you probably don't really need to remember that, just so that when you saw it, if you were wondering, oh, what does that mean? So the number in front of that has to do with the size. And if you went and looked online and went to the manufacturer for the device, they have charts and things on there telling you what size you need to encompass all kinds of things. So in your safety kit, you might want to have one that's pretty big. I know that when we had our blackouts several years ago when we were without electricity, what was that, for 5 days? I mean, I was charging my phone and my laptop in my car because I had a car charger, and my devices that I had after the second day, they had lost their power too. So keeping in mind that it might be a lot longer than what you think. It's really important for all of us to think in terms of having an app on our phone and knowing how to use it that's a speech-to-text app. So, you know, we're all thinking, well, great, I'm going to have my my hearing instrument, whatever. And the chances are you may not. And if you don't, what would you have? I mean, you could lose all kinds of things, but almost everybody's going to have their phone to be able to use your phone to have somebody speak into it so that you could read what they were saying. And of course, everybody needs to have a pocket talker. I mean, it's the standard de rigueur item for all of us that unless you have a cochlear implant and you don't have any residual hearing, for almost everybody else, it would really help you auditorily. And you might want to make sure with a pocket talker, generally, if you have your hearing devices and you would use a pocket talker because the person was further away or there was lots of background noise. So you could imagine if you were at an emergency shelter that the background noise is probably going to be really loud. And so a pocket talker could really help decrease the distance from the speaker. So theoretically, depending on how bad your hearing loss is, if you didn't have your hearing aids, you might be able to use a pocket talker with a headphone. So it would probably be a good idea to have a headphone and a neck loop in your to-go kit. So those are some of the pieces that we need specifically for people with hearing loss. And these are the things that the American Red Cross is telling us that we need, everybody needs in general. We need 3-day supply of food and 3 gallons of water per person. We need medications and a first aid kit. So you could probably talk to your physician to make sure that you either had enough of a prescription that you could keep in your first aid kit, or in addition, an additional prescription. You need flashlights and a whistle. And the reason for the whistle is that you may be so tired, could be days that you would be waiting to be rescued. It's easier to whistle than to shout. And so you could also be more debilitated and still be able to whistle, but not shout. And in Alan's video, he had the flashlight, and don't forget batteries for your flashlights, extra eyeglasses, contact lenses, a change of clothing, an extra set of car keys, money, credit card, or traveler's checks. Now, you know, there's a good chance that we might not be able to use our credit cards. So you need to have some cash. You know, the banks, the electricity could be out, the banks could be down, the ATMs might not be available. So you need to have some way to be able to pay for some things. And copies of important documents. And some of these things, as you're looking at them, especially the copies of important documents and your money, you might want to make sure to put them in a waterproof pouch so that nothing would get lost about that if they got wet for some reason. So what kind of alerting devices do we have? Do each one of us need to have to ensure that we have safety? Obviously, a smoke detector that we can be alerted to, a carbon monoxide detector, and for weather, a NOAA alerting weather radio with a strobe. So all of you know that I participate in lots of different forums and things for people who have hearing loss, and I'm always surprised by the number of people who live in tornado country who don't know about a NOAA weather radio. So this year it's added to our list just so that everybody's aware of it. It may even be that you need to be aware of it to tell somebody else you know who lives in an area that would be really, really important. So the first two things, people probably have some idea what they look like, but you probably have never seen the third one, the NOAA weather radio. So I put my slide's out of order. So I put a picture of what a alerting radio is, and you can see there it says tornado and it flashes. And if you would need one of these, you can get it from Diglo. And they're not the only person, but they always have everything. So actually, I put this slide in there and I was confused a moment ago, and I put it there because we're fortunate enough that we live in a state that offers accessories to us through the California Telephone Access Program, which is CTAP. CTAP is the acronym. And one of the accessories is the Sonic Alert Home Aware, which you see the base unit on the left-hand side of the screen. So they give that to us because it can alert you to the telephone ringing. And that's the reason that they give it to us, because it's the telephone access program. It turns out that Sonic Alert has maybe 8 different accessories that go with the home alert system. And one of them is a smoke and CO2 alert. And I have the base unit, and they gave us a presentation, I think August of last year. And I immediately got the smoke and CO2 attachment. And actually what happens is I realize anytime there's noise in and near that, like if I'm vacuuming in my bedroom, which is where I happen to have that one, great big flashing alert comes on. So it's listening for the sound of my CO2 and my smoke detector. Oops. Okay, so here again is what the weather alert radio looks like. Something that I want to let everybody know about, and I've been promoting this for, it feels like 10 years now, and it's called Smart 911. And if you live in the San Ramon Fire Department, we have this as an option. But the fire department that's the North Fire Department, they haven't signed up for it. So I'd encourage all of you, and I've written to that fire department and asked them to do it. So it would encourage all of you to go ahead and contact your fire department. And Alan, I think you have your hand up, and are you going to talk about Walnut Creek now has it, or Rossmore has it?
No, but Concord and Brentwood.
Oh.
Does have it.
Okay, so the cities did it rather than the fire department?
Right.
Okay, and so this offers you all kinds of additional options that first responders, fire departments, everybody who would ever come to you would know about for 911. So what happens is, and I couldn't think of a way to show you this, but when the 911 caller, when you call 911 and it shows your location, for the person who's answering the 911 call, they would get an additional pop-up window, and that window tells them everything that you have put into your Smart 911 account. So obviously you would want your medications and disorders that you have. You'd want to let them know that you have hearing loss. You might want to let them know what kind of hearing instrument you have. You might want to let them know what prescription medications you're taking. You might want to give them a picture of who you look like or who your children look like, so that it would be easier for them to identify you. Can you think of anything else, Alan, that you might, pets. You might want to let them know that you have a pet so that they'd go ahead and look for the pet. And this is a free service. If you happen to live in an area that Smart 911 is not activated, what happens is that if you were in your car, and in our area, so let's say they have it in from, I think it's Alamo South, and then Alan said Concord and Brentwood. So if you were driving in any of those areas that has that, and you were registered and something happened to you, that information would come up. PG&E also has information for us and tools, a whole tool kit in their Safety Action Center. And if you go ahead and go there, there's all kinds of checklists and everything else to help you and to teach you how to turn your gas and electricity off. And now I'm going to turn this over to Alan, and he's going to take you through the rest of a whole nother part of our program. Alan, you're mute.
It may seem strange that you see a yo-yo in an emergency preparedness slide deck.
Oh, and sorry. Wonder, there we go.
And wonder, well, what does a yo-yo have to do with emergency preparedness? Well, yo-yo is an acronym for you're on your own. And that is the very essence of what emergency preparedness is. Next slide. So if you are prepared, there's one less person to worry about. So, and then you're able to help your neighbors. And if you're really interested in serving the community, there are also groups where you could help the community in emergency or disaster areas. And the difference between an emergency and a disaster is your response. In an emergency, you could dial 911 and expect a prompt response. And in a disaster, you're not going to get a response from 911 because the situation would be where the public services are going to be overwhelmed by the circumstances. Let's go on to the next slide, please. So this slide, although it says Rossmore Emergency Preparedness, they are a good resource for anybody. And if you go to the website, there's quite a bit of information that you can have access to. Next slide. So that's the header of the Rossmore website. And there's resource areas there for local, state, and national organizations. Local could be CERT, which is Community Emergency Response Team. And most cities have a CERT organization. It could be anything pertaining to the Rossmore community, state resources like Cal Fire, and national resources like ready.gov and FEMA. They also have recordings of previous meetings that they've held, and a lot of those recordings have very good information and would be worthwhile to maybe go through and look at some of them. One of the best ones is one that they did recently, and it's about public utilities and what to do with them in a disaster. And that would include, like, what would you do if you had a gas leak or if a power line is down? And most people know about 911, but not too many people, I think, probably know about 211 yet. And pertaining to emergency preparedness, it provides assistance with disaster preparedness response and recovery during declared emergencies. Outside of that, it's also used for as a mental health resource and people who need help with housing, utilities, and food, employment assistance, and suicide and crisis intervention. One thing here says oxygen dependency, and we'll go into that, I think, in another, in the next slide. Slide, please. Okay, independent living resources of Solano County and Contra Costa County. This administrator of the Disability Disaster Access and Resource for the state of California. And in our case here, we want to focus with the Disability Disaster and Access Resources. And this includes a section on public safety power shutoffs. Next page, please. Next slide. So most people know what the PSPS is. That's when they have to shut off power when there's the danger of the weather conditions causing fires. And so one thing that happens with that is that you have people that rely on medical devices that needs power. And if it's shut off, then people with oxygen generators, CPAP machines, wheelchairs, once those things run out of power, then they need to be recharged, or some of them actually need the power to actually perform. And there is a program where, in conjunction with PG&E, where you can if you qualify, you could get free backup power supply. And I've actually had a couple of people in my entry here that did sign up for it and did receive the assistance. They also have information about PG&E Medical Baseline, which offers discounts to people that need assistance and with their electrical bills, and also discounts for people who qualify under the vulnerable customer situations. And next slide, please. So everybody is familiar with the Red Cross. And we're focusing here with their part in emergency preparedness. And they have a wide variety of information. Again, a lot of this information overlaps with what some of the other groups get, and some of the other groups actually get the information from each other. So that's a lot of information that's exchanged. But again, they suggest getting started with a kit, making a plan, and then staying informed. And actually, Rossmore EPO website, at the bottom of their homepage, they have a link there for people to sign up to different sources that send information out. And being in Walnut Creek, it's specific to that location, but other locations should have similar resources. And some of these are cities, some are county, some are state. Next slide. So I don't really want to get involved in this information here, except to let you know that people who do want to get involved more with the community in emergency and disaster periods, there is an organization called CERT, Community Emergency Response Team, And it does require some dedication. Initial training runs about 25 hours. And then you have to remain qualified by attending certain meetings or exercises. I think it's every 2 years to stay qualified under the Disaster Service Workers Act. And so there's my information there. And if anybody is really interested in it, I could do that, give you that information and talk to you about that offline. Next slide. And this is the header to our redesigned website. In the information section, there are information about hearing loss, but also about the information that we talked about on the emergency preparedness and then the carbon monoxide smoke detector. Let's go to the next slide, please.
Hang on a sec.
Yeah.
So, Alan, do you want me to do the rest here?
If you want to, go ahead.
Yeah. So we kept being asked by all of our chapter members about what needs to happen for disaster planning. So all of the brochures that I've developed for our chapter and for anybody else who really wants to use them are as a direct result of questions that people asked and trying to figure out a way to convey that. So we happen to have a brochure, Do You Have a Disaster Preparedness Plan? And it was set up like a checklist. So as you read through it, see in the center where the checklist is, so batteries. So if you've taken care, so you could use it as your own personal checklist. So if you already have the batteries, you can, and your to-go stuff, you can just check it off. And then now their batteries are lasting so long, it's not as much of a big deal as it was before when they didn't, but periodically you want to make sure to check and see that they're still there. So this is here, and this is on our website where Alan was telling you in under information. We also have a brochure for safety and carbon monoxide, smoke and fire, telling you about the different ways to be alerted and basically being informed of the importance of that. I believe that the rule of thumb is you have 3 minutes to get out. Well, 3 minutes is not a long time. And I know that almost everybody who had more normal hearing at one time cannot imagine that you could really never hear that shrill sound of the alerting device. And the key is that if you go to check yours now and you're standing right underneath it, you may still be able to hear it. But if you're sleeping and maybe no hearing instruments in, and maybe your head underneath your pillow, you wouldn't be awakened in enough time to get out. And we don't want that, obviously, right? We want to make sure everybody's safe. So these are available there. You can just go and look them up. If somebody wants one, since we're still not meeting in person, I'm happy to send you one. Oh, I want to go back here a minute. And so this alarm device right here is called a Lifetone. And it's made by a third party company. And we happen to have one in our ALD library, and it's pretty big. And in here, if it were fire, it flashes fire, but this only does fire, it doesn't do CO2. So you just need to be aware of that you need to be alerted by fire and CO2. And more than one device, having more than one device isn't a bad thing. I'm just making sure you know that. Yeah, Alan.
Also, if they want to print these brochures themselves, if they go to the website and go to the brochure, then there's a little square with an arrow on it. If they click on that, it'll open up a page where they could print the document.
And do you know what, everybody? At the end, we'll probably have some more time. And Alan, thanks for remembering about that, because a lot of people don't realize what that little box does. We can show that to you. So that's the end of our presentation. Does anybody have any questions or answers? Something that they, well, obviously, does anybody have any questions? Is there anything that anybody learned that they didn't know about before that they're thinking, oh, gee, I never thought of that? So we want people to participate here. Just raise your hand. You can even tell us if you thought this was a valuable presentation. Susan Beck.
I thought it was a very valuable presentation. I learned a lot, and I appreciate you putting it on.
So, Susan, can you think of one thing that sticks out that you've heard this before? Because I know you've seen it before, that this time you heard it differently. So you went, oh, I need to do that.
Well, the NOAA weather radio, and also all the things that you need to accompany your hearing devices. They kind of, you know, you think about water and food. I'm sorry if there's an echo. I have my phone to get the. Anyway, it just, and also that Concord now has the smart 911. I've been hoping that would happen. So thank you.
Yeah, well, the smart 911 isn't only in, you know, like disaster. If you had a car accident, if anything happened, you know, which are anywhere where any emergency people would be called, it would be there for you. Yeah. Thanks, Susan. And by the way, did you ever get your life tone to work?
I'm embarrassed to say that I gave up.
Well, so listen, so the pandemic is waning at least a little bit. How about if we get together and I fix it for you?
Okay, I'll get in touch with you.
Anybody else? Alan?
The PG&E slide, the Safety Action Center, is actually pretty interesting. If you go through it, it actually has a quiz that kind of guides you to see if you're ready with creating your emergency plan, if your medical devices are, you have all the equipment for that, as well as your emergency kit. And then on the page, it has a lot of short little video clips covering various topics. And so it might be something that people might actually have fun going to.
The first time we put this together, that's sort of like the current form now. When I went to the pages, there was, I had this very heartfelt feeling of being happy that and feeling grateful that I lived in a country that had resources like this that were available to us. I mean, people have spent a tremendous amount of time and effort to ensure our safety. I felt very grateful for that. So, no other comments? No questions? You know, this is supposed to be like we're in person chatting, right? Okay, so if nobody has, oh, Susan.
Yes. Is it possible? I'm sorry about that echo. Is it possible for me to send this recording to friends who don't belong to HLAA?
We have a YouTube channel. Our chapter has a YouTube channel, and every single one of our meetings is on our YouTube channel. And what we'll do is when we go to the website to show you what that little pop-out box is on our, oh, we just launched a new website, Alan, I think, what was it, 2 weeks ago, maybe?
Something like that.
Yeah. And you might not notice the difference because it looks very similar to our old website, but it's now much more up to date in the technology pieces that are behind the scenes. So we can go ahead and show you where that pop-up window is. And I believe there's a link on the homepage now to our YouTube channel as well. So if you just went to the homepage and clicked on that, it would take you there. So Bob's here, I see him. And if we were meeting in person, this would be when Bob would be giving us all his homemade muffin, which we love. So this kind of makes it feel like we're not quite so far apart for us, for me. We have some announcements. So upcoming events for our chapter on October 1st, we're going to have what hopefully we can get a lot of enough publicity about this. And Pat Dobbs, who lives in Maine, see the wonderful options that we have because we can still Zoom, is going to be giving us a presentation on partner communication. Hearing loss is a family affair. On November 5th, we switched our December meeting, our November meeting to December, and we're still working on the arrangements for November. And December 3rd, we're very lucky to have Sherry Eberts and Gail Hannon, who have just released their brand new book called Hear and Beyond, Live Skillfully with Hearing Loss. I purchased the book right after it was released, and it's really, really, I really liked it. And Alan has some things up his sleeve about maybe we're going to have a drawing for the book. We just need to figure out how to go about and arrange that. I ordered my book through Amazon. If you like to read and you would like to hear what somebody else is saying about it, I thought it was the most inclusive book that I may have ever read. I also like the layout and the format of the book. We've had both Sherry and Gail give us presentations before. And so most of you who are here today have an idea of what they look like. And what they did is in the, oh, and you all know I love to read. So they have little caricatures of each one of them at the beginning of where they, in specific places where they talk, and they carried it through the whole book. So I think that that's a really, for me, it's a very amusing piece. And I kind of feel like I'm really with them when they're talking and it's not just the spoken, you know, not just the written word. It was really personal. Let me see if you can see that. See their little heads? Okay, so we talked about also upcoming, and we don't know whether we haven't really signed up to participate. I'm still kind of worried about, at this time, I'm not so fearful of just getting COVID because I'm vaxxed and boosted and everything else. But I don't want to get long-term COVID, and they don't have any, there's no criteria for who gets it and who doesn't. So we're still deferring meeting in person, but the Lafayette Community Foundation is hosting their Aging by Design on, I think it's the 7th of September. Oh no, it must be the 9th we were talking about. And Alan was saying that Rossmore is having their emergency preparedness event on October 15th. And I think, Alan, are you planning on participating in that? Or you haven't decided yet?
I probably will.
Okay, so, you know, we're all fence sitting here. But those are events in case that was something that you might want to go to. We're still looking for committee members. Zohair is the chair for our programs committee. And they've been meeting once a month. And so we're just letting everybody know that others are welcome. And of course, you know, I'm always looking for other advocates to join me in advocating in our community. And recently, Jim Schroeder has done some advocacy work in the last month in Benicia. And so we're hoping to develop some important things here. Actually, you know, Smart 911, if some of you who have it now in communities where you live, we could start advocating in other cities and using that as a tool, saying, oh, well, listen, Concord has it, Brentwood has it, you know, what's wrong? You know, if everybody competes with each other, it would be really nice if we had it throughout all of Contra Costa County. It would be really nice if we had it in the whole state. Another issue that it's looking at low-hanging fruit for us, and one of them that has been here for a considerable amount of time, is that the city of San Francisco was the first place in the United States to require captions on all public televisions. And in California, it's been pretty much city by city. And I would like the state to mandate that, but I think it might be, as a step before that, it might be easier for us to get the county of Contra Costa, the planning commission, to mandate that captions be turned on in all public televisions in our county. So that's something that's on my agenda in addition to hospitals. So here's a look at one of the parts of our new website. And as you can see, this top part here looks very similar to our old website. And we'd like to let everybody know, in case you're not already a member, that we are a member organization. And you can attend all of our events without being a member, but to do the work that we like to do in the community, to host our meetings, to pay for our Zoom and captions and things, it does cost us money. So just to remind you that you can renew your membership online. So you go online to our website, you click on membership, and when you're a member, you're automatically notified because we have a special system. That's a hardware system that takes care of that for us. And in this membership place, those are what the fees are. And you'll have an option to either pay with PayPal, or you can click on this tab and you can click a membership renewal form and mail it to us, whichever you like. So all of you know that accessibility and advocating for our rights is dear to my heart. Because without the accessibility that we need, we're all cloistered and homebound. There's nothing, we can't enjoy the things that we wanted to do before. And as it turns out, in my opinion, we are the stepchild of the disability movement. I believe that we should be seeing the hearing access symbol as frequently and as often as we see the universal disability access sign, which for most of us signals just, and I don't mean just, signals mobility issues. So every grocery store we go to has mobility parking. None of the grocery stores we go to in our county have hearing access. So communication access helps people with hearing loss the same way ramps help people with mobility issues. So maybe if we keep repeating this and we keep repeating this, it'll get easier for people to ask for what they need. The ADA was 32 years old this year. It's not new. There's nobody who can say that I don't know anything about it. Why isn't it here? All the city governments were required to create a transition plan. We were included in that transition, supposed to be included in that transition plan. Unfortunately, as I started to say, we're the stepchild in the disability movement. Everybody sees all kinds of things for people with mobility issues, low vision, and very little for people with hearing loss. And we need to continue to speak up. And where? We want it everywhere. You want it at your church. You want it at the ball game. You want it at the bank. You want it at the museum, at your pharmacy, at your hospital, on your bus, at the airport. A reminder to everybody, you know, because of the pandemic, all of the major the major infrastructure in our country has received all kinds of funds from the government. So they can use some of those funds to provide us with the accessibility that we need. They don't have the excuse that they don't have the money. They have money. They just need to set some aside for us. So that's the end of our presentation here. And I think what I'd like to do, Alan, is go ahead and go to our website. And so I'll go through some of the new things and like, especially the box that you were talking about. So let me go ahead and pull it up. And would everybody like that? Would people like to see these features on the on our website? Okay. So I didn't see thumbs up, but people didn't leave. So I'm assuming that that means that everybody wants to see it. Okay, so here's our new website. And see here where it says YouTube? That's our YouTube channel. And see here is this box with an arrow. And Alan has even made it so cool now that when you put your cursor over that box, it tells you what happens. So it says open a new window, which we're going to do. Now, I'm not sure. Did it switch to our YouTube window? Some tell me, put thumbs up because I don't know what you see. Did it? Yeah. So these are tons of our videos. And they're in here for, here are all our videos. Here's Gail Hannon's video when she gave a presentation to our chapter last time. Oh, we have 250 views on that. So Susan, we have the presentation from last year here, which is right here, about the same presentation too. You could send your friends both of them. Okay. And we have a couple of other things that are in here that you may not, if you came to look. One is this about hearing loss. This is a short piece that I've used in multiple different things since 2016 with revisions. I'm going to go ahead and play it for you so that you can see it. And there's no sound with it. Everything is... So there are many opportunities that I've had to be able to have short pieces connected to something. And this is what I usually use. Oops, don't want to go there. Okay, so if you'd like to subscribe to our e-news, and I think everybody here already is because you've got our meeting announcement, you just click here. Automatically takes you to a subscription option for the e-news. When Alan was talking about here, we'll open up the emergency preparedness. Okay, see here, the box with the arrow again. When you click on that, It takes you just to the document. And so you could just print right from here if you wanted to do that. And consistently, this box with the arrow takes you to another window that is opening just that window. And Alan put here, here's a link to the Red Cross. Here's a link to ready.gov. Okay, so Alan, can you think of some other things you'd like people to learn how to be able to use on our website?
I don't think there's anything at the moment that's really different, except for maybe if you go to events and to the meeting schedule. And so if you hover over the event, it gives some additional information. And if we have the registration link ready, it would also have the registration link.
Oh, so Alan, are you saying that in the future, we'll start adding the registration link here too, so giving people more options to be able to register?
Right. If you go to the first one.
There we go. Thank you. So here was the registration for our meeting today. I'd also like to I keep repeating this over and over again. I'm hoping that people sometime will start using this. We had a major project and it was, people kept saying, well, I don't know what to ask for. I don't know what to do. How do I get accommodations? So the first thing that came out of that was the development of this brochure called Ask for Communication Access. And so this tells you, and it's a little bit dated right now, but these are the options for what kind of technology you might ask for. So you can see here what those are. This tells you what's covered, who to ask for, and where. So then people said, well, okay, but I don't know who to ask. Who do I ask? And city and local government are Title II under the ADA. They're required to have all of their programs and services accessible for people with disabilities. That means us. And when we look at a program or service, that's any single thing you would use in city government. If you go to a city government counter in the building department and they don't have any kind of assistive technology for you to understand them, you need to ask, because they're required to have that. I'm here to tell you, more than likely, they're not going to have it, but we need to keep pushing them, because if we don't, they're never going to have it. Okay, so the next piece that came out of that was, so who do we ask for in city government? So what happened was, we were developing a list of ADA coordinators in the city, in the county of Contra Costa County. And we were thinking that if we had this list, then it would be easier for all of our members, all of you here, to be able to figure out, who do I contact? Well, as it turned out, we ended up expanding it to the whole state of California. Alan did just a bang up job here. Okay, so these are governmental ADA coordinators in the state of California. So if you live in Concord, if you live in Walnut Creek, if you live anywhere, all you do is here, if you click on the jurisdiction, it just alphabetized them. So here's the person for Alameda County, and it happens to be the city clerk. So frequently, so that you know, If the city clerk is the designated ADA coordinator, generally they don't have an official ADA coordinator, which they're required to have, and somebody needs to nudge them. So on this list, see this plus right there? When you click on that plus, a drop-down window opens up. It gives you the phone number, the website, additional information, the address, where they're located, everything. Okay, so then that part, so that got expanded to be all of California. And I would love to have this for the whole United States. I don't know how that would happen yet at this time, but it's a dream of mine. So the next piece that came out of this, well, I think that all of you know that I sit on the HLAA Get in the Hearing Loop Committee. And so we have been diligently working for a long time for tools for advocates. And Sherry Parazzoli, the chair, and I both really created our own tools because no tools really existed. And so we have a Get in the Hearing Loop toolkit that exists today. We're in the process of creating a handbook and an advocacy guide. And as part of this, there were hearing loops that were installed throughout the United States and trying to compile a list. Now, some people created some lists that weren't accurate. There are two apps that don't have accurate lists. So we didn't feel that we could tell people to really use them. So for example, in our county, one of the apps listed every single city council chamber is having a hearing loop and they all have FMs. So all that information was wrong. Well, anyway, so since I'm involved in these things, I had the list of what we had of known hearing loop venues in California. And that's what's here. So these are the known hearing loops that we know in California. If you want to know what's available in your area, you click there and it alphabetizes everything. You click it the other way and it goes the other direction. And there may be hearing loops that aren't here. So at the request of the HLAA Get in the Hearing Loop Committee, we approached Google Maps. And at our request, they added an accessibility feature for hearing loops. And this was officially launched in late spring. Now you can go on your phone. Before you go anyplace, do you want to know, does this place have a hearing loop? So you go on your phone and you go to the About section. Let's see, I can do it on my computer, but it's not going to be as easy for you to see. You go to the About section and you click on About and then you scroll down. And there's a place there, it says accessibility and it says assistive hearing loop. So our committee has been seeding Google Maps with hearing loops domestically and in Canada. We have sent them over 5,000 loops. We hope that the Google Maps will continue to have additional loops, including international loops. So this is a way that that all of us are going to be able to much more easily find out and be prepared before we go. So if anybody knows of a hearing loop that's not on this list, please let me know and I'll ensure that it is added to the HLAA list. And also I'm getting ready to send out one of our MailChimps about directions on how to add to the list. And also we have a survey, a document that we created to help you be able to list an individual loop. You just fill it in with all the information. It's a couple pages that automatically behind the scenes comes to the Get in the Hearing Loop Committee. So these things are all here for you. We want you to use them. I didn't create the documents and the other things because I didn't want anybody to use them. Alan hasn't taken all this time and effort to create this fabulous website for us because we hope that it just sits here and nobody uses it. So our hope is if we continue to talk about it and share with you what's really here, that it might make it easier for you to use it. We recognize that most of us didn't grow up with this technology, and it's not secondhand for us like it is for people in their 30s. And so the more we go ahead and go over it, the greater the chances are that the first thought you'll think of rather than a book is, oh, we need to go to the website. And this is, whether it's our website or anybody else's website, this particular window here is really, really, really important because sometimes it can be hard to find what you're looking for. So this is called a search window, and its icon is the magnifying glass. So sometimes you'll see the magnifying glass, but it's hard to see the other box. Just click on that magnifying glass and the box will open up. Okay, so I'm gonna put something in here, and I hope I'm gonna be lucky it comes up. So emergency, so we know we have a brochure and we have the YouTubes. I don't know what's gonna happen. And Alan, have you checked this? Oh, well, there we go. It came up as emergency preparedness here. Okay, so smart 911. So see, all kinds of additional information is here. And all you really had to do was put one word in there. So that makes it a whole lot easier. So I can't think of anything else to share here. So we changed. There used to be some of these things were at the top in the menu bar up here. And now they're actually at the bottom. So it makes the most important things the easiest to find. And if you have never read the book that HLAA put out that were quotes from Rocky Stone, I really recommend it. I really didn't understand why everybody kept talking about this person who really hadn't been with us for a really long time. I had never met him. And when I read his invisible condition, I was so moved, it brought tears to my eyes. And so we've always left it here. So here under HLAA history, when you click this, there's his book, and it was compiled 14 years of editorials. And here's the book, and you can download it. And it's 83 pages, and HLAA actually had this in a hardback that they sold for some time before my time. Very, very moving. So, and here's the box again. You can do that. If you didn't want to download it and print 80 pages. And just pick what you want and read anything you want for inspiration. He was really a very amazing man. Let's pick one little thing. Okay. The most pervasive physical handicap in America today is an invisible condition, hearing loss. Because it's invisible, it affects us in varying degrees of severity. The ability to deny it is enhanced. The smaller the loss, the more we or our parents are able to deny it or conceal it and delay efforts to cope, to face the fact that adjustments must be made. The greater the loss, the more we or our parents are compelled to recognize it and to do something about it. SHUSH was founded for all of us, hearing and hard of hearing alike. It was founded because of my conviction that little progress toward prevention, detection, management, or possible remedies can be made until we all better understand the reality of the situation. Hearing loss is about communication. It's involved with a problem of listening and trying to understand what is being said, rather than just hearing noise and isolated words. Amplification on the telephone permits me easily to hear sound of another voice. My trouble is I can't understand what that voice says. Along the spectrum of hard of hearing people, there are many different problems, and the method of alleviation may vary. What works in one case may not work in another, but there is one common denominator. Hearing loss affects human beings. Being human is both unique and precious. As we expound our philosophy in these pages, you will see that belief as the foundation of thought and uppermost in our minds in what we advocate. Being human is both unique and precious. The whole thing is like this. So I hope that you all take an opportunity to possibly take a look at that. And so I might have missed, if we hadn't been going through the webpage, I might have missed mentioning that that's really there. And a lot of you might not have even known that. So I don't have anything else to say. Does anybody have something that they would like to comment about? That we have some people here from the East Bay chapter, something that's going on over there. Now, if you didn't remember, they meet on the second Saturday of the month, so you can always attend their meeting as well. Anything else?
Are you going to announce Ella Massman?
Oh, well, I didn't want to have it be a sad place to leave, but since you brought it up, so many of us from our chapter, the East Bay chapter in Northern California, attended lip reading classes with our beloved Ellen Mastman, and I received news that she passed away. I don't have very many details about it. Someone after I kept following up told me that they had heard she had cancer. I sent an email out to those of us who I knew had taken lip reading with her this morning and sent the address to send a card to her husband if you'd want to do so. This is a tremendous loss for all of us. I think that Ellen taught lip reading in and around San Jose and in Palo Alto, and all of us in our chapter took it at Dakara when she taught there. I was hoping for a long time that she'd move online completely, and my understanding is during the pandemic her classes did move online, but we do not have anywhere near the number of lip reading, speech reading teachers anywhere in the United States that we all need. You know, it's a reminder, right? I was genuinely shocked because I didn't know that she was even sick. How important it is to do what you really need and want to do every single day so that your day is filled with things that bring you happiness, because none of us know how long we're here. You know. So anything else? Kathy, nice to see you. So Kathy is from the East Bay chapter and she attends almost all our meetings.
I do, and I not only enjoy them, but I learn something at every meeting, especially from you, Anne. Today, I can't believe how much I learned just listening to you and Alan. Again today, kind of refreshed me, even though I've heard your presentation at least once and probably a couple times before, but I learn something every day when I join the DV chapters. Well, of course, in addition to our East Bay chapter, which is meeting, as you said, on the second Saturday of the month. We have an interesting meeting coming up. In fact, next Saturday, I won't be there because I unfortunately have to go to memorial for a friend who died of COVID recently, but I'm hoping some of you can join. It's going to be by Dr. Allison Freeman, Coping with Hearing Loss, taking care of our mental health. Of course, we're talking about, you know, all the things that have gone on with mental health, but particularly in relation to people who have hearing loss, like you and me. So hope you can join in. And of course, I'll be providing a summary of the presentation in the, let's see, it would be the, let's see, the, I guess it would be in the October newsletter. So if you miss out on it, take a look at that, please.
And for those of you who don't know Allison, she's also hard of hearing.
Yes.
She lives in the Los Angeles area and is a member of the Los Angeles chapter.
Yes. She has given this presentation before, so I believe it's going to be a video presentation with follow-up by her for questions and answers. At the same time as you run your meetings, 10 to about 11:30, sometimes it goes a little later to about 12. So please feel free to join us. And I know some of you do regularly. I know Alan and Anne, oftentimes you join Anne and Bob. So please continue to do so. You're always welcome. And any new people who would like to join in, of course, are welcome as well.
Yeah. So you had a presentation that I wasn't able to attend to because I went to a celebration. And that was your meeting last month about cochlear implants. And
yes.
I know that we have other people here who have cochlear implants. And if somebody wants to see that, that's available to view as a video.
It is. Actually, it was quite a marvelous presentation. One of the best I've seen on cochlear implants. And Anne, I was actually a little surprised to not see you there because I know you have a cochlear implant. Do you have two or is it just one? Okay, you have two. I actually don't have a cochlear implant. So I thought, well, it might not be of much interest to me, but you know what? I found out it was quite interesting and very detailed and a lot of good PowerPoint slides and demonstrations about how cochlear implants work. If you want to see my summary, it is on the, or will be posted soon if you haven't already, if they haven't already posted it, of my summary in the newsletter. So you can always go to our website, which is here, let's see, hearinglosseb.org. So feel free to check that out when it comes out. And otherwise, if you want a copy of the recording, you can contact are either Dale or George Chan, who takes care of sending those out.
Thanks. Say, Bob Zastro, are you getting another implant?
I don't know yet if I'm going to get a second implant. And they say, he told me the VA normally does not get seconds, but they're about it. With the doctor directly, the doctor that does the implants, and see if he'll approve a second implant.
So you're still waiting to hear?
I'm still waiting. I did have another hearing test, but I failed magnificently. Bone conduction, we tried that. I said the stress loss was conductive loss. Not a sensory neural loss.
Oh.
The bone conduction test, I got zero reception on low sounds. All I got was a bunch.
Yeah. So for those of you who are here, when it's a conductive loss, it means that your middle ear has these little bones in them. And the bones, okay, so the sound goes in from your outer ear into your middle ear, and these bones vibrate, and that's what sends the sound impulse forward. And so if there's something going on with that middle place, The sound doesn't get to your cochlea, doesn't get to your inner ear. And so whenever there's something with the middle ear like that, it's called a conductive hearing loss. So Bob, do they think you have otosclerosis? Do they have any idea why you're having this middle ear problem?
No, I don't know. I did, when it first started, I did have an infection. And I didn't know I had an infection for a couple of days, but then the pressure built up, ruptured the eardrum. And from what the last check, I still had a hole in the eardrum that's never healed.
So you do know that they can perform a surgery where they patch that.
Right, they mentioned that. I don't know yet what's going to happen.
Okay, so just checking in on you, you know. This is our chance every month to kind of get caught up to date with everybody.
I know. I'll be going down to see you hopefully the next week or so.
Thanks. Okay, everybody. So last chance. Anybody want to say anything? Julie Johnson, don't you want to say hello?
Hello, everybody. I'm just so glad that, you know, I found HLAA. I would have been lost. So thank you so much. And Anne, I hope we're going to talk sometime soon.
Good.
I have some things I want to talk to you about.
Good. Did you start your business?
No.
Okay. I'm keeping my fingers crossed.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, everybody. So then we'll see you next month. And I'll try and put together a MailChimp to let everybody know about the events that are happening. Sometimes, you know, I get to that. Sometimes I just don't get there. So talk to you later. Thanks for coming. Have a nice weekend and stay cool.